Macmillan Audio presents Our Migrant Souls, written by Héctor Tobar, narrated by André Santana. Prologue. Our Migrant Souls. You write words for me to read, a string of memories that place me inside the eyes of the child you were, a daughter of Honduras, of Mexico, and of Puerto Rico, and of the Central Valley of California, with its flat, dry plains covered with crops and cows, and towns filled with baisas and their chickens. You sit in my office and begin to weep as you tell me the story of your undocumented boyfriend and the demons that haunt him. And it is clear to me that you should break up with him, even though I cannot say this. You tell me about your best friend, a white girl, and about the African-American family who lived next door. In your stories, I see a suburb of rectangular lawns and a rancho in the rural United States, where the neighbors heard your mother and father yelling at each other, and where you took solace in the natural beauty of your surroundings, in the crisp desert wind and the muddy yellow outline of mountain ranges. You write, "I am having a nervous breakdown," but your prose belies this, controlled and precise. It tells a story of violation and survival you endured when you were a kindergartner. I read the pages you write for me, and I learn that, as a child, you were the good daughter who helped raise her siblings. You were the son who worked alongside your father in his landscaping business. You were the daughter who rubbed your father's weary feet every night, and you recount the months you were living in your car, with your parents and brother, taking baths at night at the spigot outside a laundromat. You describe the water flowing over your butt cheeks in a way I'll never forget. When your parents were depressed and nearly broken, you kept the home together. You witnessed your mother disappear to confront your father's lover, and you watched the home invaders who arrived in your living room, criminals speaking poor Spanish with their children in tow. You cooked, and you drove siblings to doctor's appointments, and now I see you sitting before me, your sense of humor intact, an awareness and a dignity and a purpose about you. In a minute, you will become frazzled, but 15 minutes later, you will recover yourself. Your eyes dart nervously, and then suddenly, I see the centered you, and I want to weep because I can see you walking into the future unbroken. Your coloring, the shape of your nose, and the raven locks that drop over your forehead suggest the world and its variety. An African heritage, your indigeneity, your Europeanness, you are everything. And you are the very specific places your parents came from. You are Texas and Oaxaca and Andalusia and villages with burros and concrete cities covered in wires and digital signals. Like my own DNA, yours is a cipher of secrets and chance encounters and migrations. Your story passes through Guatemala and Compton. It has side routes into Tennessee and North Carolina. You describe bringing home your African-American boyfriend and your Mexican father gazing up at him and saying with admiration, "Es alto el cabrón." You gaze back into your history and you show me market towns in Central American valleys that straddle rivers lined with ceiba trees. Ethnicity and race are sold to us as boxes containing our skin tones and our surnames, but the truth about you, about us, will not fit in any box. You have the labels undocumented and Mexican and Cubana attached to you, and yet English is your mother tongue, and your favorite band is the Smiths. You were born in the United States, but you can speak Zapotec. You describe again and again how terrible you feel about your Spanish or your lack of it, because Spanish is this language that's supposed to bind us to our people and our past. You are a deep brown, and you are fair-skinned. Your eyes are black, and they are green, and you are 19 and 20 and 21, and you are brilliant in the same way your mother and father were. Those sharp-eyed, impulsive, and impatient border crossers who begot you, Barrio math wizards who dropped out of school in the sixth grade. My mother is a savant, you tell me. Never formally educated, still undocumented, she builds a jewelry empire with your father. Your parents sell tacos one day, and decades later, they own a horse ranch. From the kitchen at a Chinese fast food restaurant, to bartering at the swap meet, to the chain holding the keys to their own business. But you are hurt today. So many hateful words have been spoken about us. Ancient tropes, crude insults tossed carelessly into the stream of images and voices of the modern age. This country posits us as an uneducated people, as servers and brawn, as cleaners of floors and toilets picking up the trash. We are the laboring backdrop to this country's affluence. Our humanity and our complexity exist outside broadcast and printed culture, rarely as alive and full as I see in your writing. I read your account of your mother's solitary journey to California and the apartment where she lived with 18 people, and your father's stubborn efforts to court her. He never did quite succeed in sweeping her off her feet. You describe family wreckage and pride and alcoholism and the joys of first kisses and what it's like to still live in the closet and how much it hurt when your ignorant Thea said those things about women who love other women. You are the daughter whose mother never caught her fooling around with her güerita girlfriend in her bedroom under the covers during sleepovers until she read your journal. Now you write words for me to read, in this place of learning where you came in search of useful knowledge that will bring sense to the conflict and disorder around you. You want the power of printed words and ideas to flow through your veins for the rest of your days. This is why you have sought me out. Your eyes drift to the books on the shelves in my office, each one representing learning and reason, the power of studied truths revealed. And this, indeed, is what I want to give you. I see you, 10 rows back during my lecture on Central American and Caribbean history in the 20th century. I am showing slides of dictators in epaulettes and guerrilla fighters wearing secondhand t-shirts exported to El Salvador from the goodwills of the United States and the papery leaves of drought-stricken cornfields and boys and girls with the bloated bellies of malnutrition. I show you the logos of the United States companies that transformed our homelands into banana republics. And I say, we think we're a fucked up people, but it's this history that's fucked up. All this violence inflicted upon us, that is what haunts us. As I speak, I see you, 10 rows back, wiping away a tear, and I think, I came into this world and I mastered words and studied history just so I could stand here before you. Diana, Isaac, Andrea, Elizabeth, Christiane, Delia, so that I could show you the hurt, the daring, and the beauty to be found in our shared histories. The women who gave their bodies to the Mexican Revolution, the gender-fluid soldadera who led troops into battle in her leather pants. I've come here after decades of study so that I could see you sit up straight in the lecture hall, a smile forming on your lips now, because in the scroll of knowledge I have opened for you, you see a truth that's always been there, around you, inside you, unspoken. This is my mission now. Here, in my own pages, which are meant to honor your stories and add to them, I will weave what I know with what you have taught me. And together we will arrive at an understanding of our times and our people. And we will be stronger and ready for the next fight, and the one after that, and all the many struggles to come. I have 3 children who are about the same age as you. My wife and I raised them in the years and decades when racist ideas about people of Latin American descent were spreading across the United States. We wanted them to be strong and happy inside their skins. As with many people of my generation and yours, the spread of intolerance across our country only made us more determined and defiant to take pride in everything that made us primitive to and despised by the ignorant and the ill-informed. For us, as for most Latino families, our fortitude is grounded in the realization that we are on a journey that is generations long. Our ancestors look back at us from old black and white photographs and from the faded Polaroids of the last century, and in their steely expressions or their old country optimism, we see a shield in a world of cruel judgments. In our history, we see the germ of the human worth, beauty, and dignity of our people. But what does it mean to say we are a people? What do we pass on to our children when we call ourselves Latino, or its many synonyms? Truth be told, those of us who can call ourselves Latino feel ridiculous half the time we use the term. Latino, Latinx, and Hispanic all have European roots. As such, they erase our indigenous and African past, and they are repeated so often in superficial reports in the United States media, where few Latino faces are visible, that they can feel as fake and artificial as a marketing slogan or a cartoon. Latino, Latinx, and Hispanic are terms that are said to describe our ethnicity or common cultural background. In practice, however, the rest of the country treats us as a race. Police transmissions describe Hispanic male suspects, and news reports list Latino alongside the races white, black, Native American, and Asian when discussing the demographics of the United States. Behind these categories is the belief that race is a biological subdivision of the species Homo sapiens, and that the members of the same race are similar in more ways than just skin color. Racist ideas about Latino people are tied to the belief that we are born into a lower caste, and that, as a people, we are inconsequential in the American story. This is not just an attitude held by white people, as one Asian American student reminded me. At a time when many of my students were writing about the wave of anti-Asian hate during the COVID-19 pandemic, he told me the story of his Hong Kong immigrant family and the mother who scolded the son who became a car mechanic instead of going to college. She told him, "You might as well be Mexican." Many a Latino parent has felt the shroud of racial prejudice hovering over their children. We think of our progeny and their brilliant minds, their brightness and their eagerness as they go into the world, and the way strangers will dismiss them or not see them because of the stereotypes attached to our people. I've watched my children fight, as I've seen you fight, to assert their intelligence and creativity and willfulness against the smallness and the stupidity of those who see us through a race lens. Race is an invention of long-dead ideologues and long-discredited scientists who collected skulls and told fairy tales about them. Perhaps you have sensed this already, as you walk about the culturally diverse spaces of North America. Real human beings and their bodies and their faces and their idiosyncrasies don't fit into the coloring books that the United States has created to illustrate what race means. Race is a story we tell ourselves about one another. In the case of people of Latin American descent, that story was born from a history of conquest and exploitation, and from our own acts of resistance to exploitation and prejudice. You and I, and countless authors and activists, use Latino or Latinx or Hispanic to express an alliance among peoples, a shared experience. But in the intimate spaces of your friendships and your homes, you are not inclined to use these terms. When you are asked the annoying question, "What are you?" you are more likely to answer with something more specific and more satisfying, something closer to your lived experience. "I'm Mexican," you might say, even if you were born in the United States. Or, "My father's Salvadoran and my mother's Irish." Or, "I'm from a mixed status family." Or, "I'm New Yorican." Or you might say, as many of my students have said over the years, "I'm from South Central LA," or "I'm Blaxican," because your identity has been born of the contact between people of African American and Latin American descent, something common in all the cities of the United States. Like the other racial and ethnic terms in this country, Latino and Hispanic were created as counterpoints to white. To call a human being white itself is strange.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.